has been about. And I think that it's been about two things. I think it's been about bringing people together in creative and innovative ways. And there's a lot that can be said about the psychological principles that we have employed to do this between Soviets and Americans. While our governments, working in a traditional model of diplomacy which sees Soviets and Americans as fundamentally different and therefore antagonistic, we citizen diplomats have been able to hold the opposites together. So that while we go over as Americans and all that Americans need in the world today, which is not having more weapons, but embracing those fundamental principles that built this country, like honesty, like directness, like equality, that is what's gone into the successes that all of us have partaken in. The second thing about citizen diplomacy, which to me is equally fundamental, is that what has characterized citizen diplomacy is work on the frontiers of the Soviet-American relationship. We have not addressed ourselves to the arms control negotiations in Geneva. We haven't, to a large extent, engaged in trade. But what we have done is we have begun to bring Soviets and Americans together in ways like satellite link-ups, in ways like bringing Middle America over, in ways like taking healers over, in ways that have brought astronauts and cosmonauts together, in ways that have brought the health professionals of both countries together, in ways like Cindy Lazarov, who have brought the youth together, not just for information exchanges, but to go climb a mountain. So that what we have done is not only bring to bear new psychological principles concerning diplomacy itself, and for the first time, people en masse have begun to take international relations as a matter of personal priority and personal responsibility, but we've done it in extraordinarily creative ways. And I believe that it is that we have to focus in on as the government begins to take more and more of the mandate back. Because after all, successful citizen diplomacy is when the government feels permission to do these things. And we got a call into our office by a woman who is probably the most knowledgeable person in the United States on the Soviet military-industrial complex. And for a long time, she says, I believe that citizen diplomats have a fundamental obligation to begin to interface with the existing political establishment. One of the things that I have been gratified by in terms of working with citizen diplomacy, I might just engender a little personal note here, is that when I don't have much wisdom, and that Europe is the mother of both the United States and the Soviets. And because she's the mother, she has an awful lot to teach us. If we would stop being two bullies that divide and currently rip her apart. The third thing that I think that we have to focus in on, which, again, this is all coming out of my experience, so this isn't necessarily systemic, but I had a very interesting experience in Northern Ireland after the astronaut-cosmonaut conference where I was asked by the University of Ulster to give an address on the connections between what citizen diplomats have been doing between America and the Soviet Union and the Northern Irish problem. And I'm telling you, getting off the plane and to being taken on a tour of Belfast and Londonderry and talking with people, one man having very recently lost his son to the IRA, you're talking with people that are in real intense conflict in a polarized environment. And the discussions that we had over a day and a half about what they could learn from us and what we could learn from them was very, very interesting. The second experience that I had was with a woman named Susan Silk of the Columbia Foundation in San Francisco. Jim Hickman and Paul Rosenblum and I went to speak with her about finances. We are in the same boat everybody else is in. And we were trying to figure out a way that we could access West Coast funders, because most of our funding comes from the East Coast. And she said, after reading an essay that Jim and I had just written called The Psychological Principles of Citizen Diplomacy, she says, you've got to talk to people coming from Central America. She says, I have a stack of between 20 and 30 proposals, funding proposals on my desk, and every single one of them are pro-Sandinista. And all the other people are pro-Contra. That's just like the US-USSR Friendship Society. It's basically pro-Soviet. And she says, what you citizen diplomats are trying to achieve, and in fact are achieving, is a third way, which holds the polarities, which doesn't make judgments. And maybe you should be talking with people from Central America. You know, and I'm delighted to see that you've got refugees telling their story and third world enterprising at Asilomar. That's fundamentally important. Because I think that, amongst other things, we've got to understand that the East-West conflict is happening within the context of North-South tensions. And I don't need to say anything about that. So I think that what we have to do is begin to distill down the psychological principles that we are learning and apply them to other ways, not in a we can tell you how to do it, but in a corporate dialogue that begins to see, you know, like with the Europeans moving from bilateral to multilateral. Let's just see. You know, let's, instead of taking a bunch of Americans over to the Soviet Union, why don't we start stopping in London or Frankfurt for a couple of days, meeting with people like from Greenham Common, people really engaged in the struggle, people who've been going and dealing with the Soviets in their own way, and taking two or three or four of them with us, starting to include Eastern Europeans. It'd be very interesting to go to the Soviet Union with Poles, with East Germans.
If you can stay in a framework of non-judgment.
Right. I mean, that's the challenge of citizen diplomats. And so that there's all kinds of challenges that I believe that we have to address. From maintaining the continuity, from beginning to interface more systemically with our own traditional diplomats as citizen diplomats, bilateral to multilateral, distilling down the psychological principles and seeing if they're applicable in other ways, in other contexts. And I think that if we can begin to move to those frontiers, that citizen diplomacy will just open up a whole new area that 5 or 10 years later, the governments will say, gosh, that sounds like a good idea. And that comes back to my original point that as history moves, we have to keep moving. Because history, in light of the nuclear crisis that we're in, is in a hurry. And it's got very specific agendas, because it's coming up from the earth herself. And it's the spirit of the earth that's commanding the priorities here. Our task as people on her surface is to hear what she's saying and to continue to move in the areas where she gives us the vision to even see. If we can see it, we'll have the strength to do it. If we can maintain the non-judgmentalness, which is the fundamental characteristic, I believe, of a vessel, and can see that there is a multiplicity of strands that come together when people link with people, with the singular challenge of doing that linkage in innovative ways on the frontier of the relationship. Hope I haven't talked too much.
No.
Question time?
Yeah, so we have 30 minutes for questions.
Yeah, and for just before we get any questions, and a lot of the judgments that people make have to do with the fact that they've never been to Europe to see, for example, that houses are smaller, that bathrooms are tinier, that standards of everything are different. And it's always almost would seem worthwhile to make a rule that people have to go somewhere else first before they go to the Soviet Union, just to broaden that context of education.
That seems to me critical in the non-judging to come from. And I'm wondering, what is your experience in teaching people not to judge or to see their own judgments and know that it's a judgment and put it aside?
Most people instinctively understand that that's our particular charism, as it were, in going to the Soviet Union.
Because that includes not judging our government also. And that's, I think, as Americans, what is most difficult.
Yeah, I mean, I would just say, I just underscore that. I mean, it's very interesting in terms of the psychological mechanisms of enemy formation, which is something I'm doing a pretty interesting research in right now, that most of the say the moral majority think that citizen diplomats have got to understand that there's on the one hand we have to assimilate the polarities, but on the other hand we can't get caught, which is, I believe, the Achilles heel of a lot of citizen diplomats that I talk to, of just saying, you know, we go over and we explore the humanity, we don't make any judgments about anybody. I don't believe that's true. I believe that we have to both understand the common humanity that unites Soviets and Americans, and we have to understand that there are fundamental differences between Soviets and Americans. And it's that ability to see the differences as well as appreciate the commonality that I think is the real task.
You know, there's a difference in comparing and judging, you know, in seeing the differences, you just see that. But in judgment, it's actually the comparison of those differences. And I know with our people that we're going to take over, we're going to bring this out because this is an important point. Sometimes people feel that to be non-judgmental, you lose your discrimination. So I think it's a matter of semantics and the way the words are used that confuse some people. Mm-hmm. We've run into this with people that we've taken on our trips who felt that they had to be discriminating and see the evil that existed within the Soviet Union. But of course, I think if they realize that's truly not discrimination, you know, that it helps to work that out.
You know, one of the things, for instance, that we're doing, which just takes us a step further, one of the things that we're doing is beginning to engage in more discussion with immigrants on this side. We have a program that's being done actually at Esalen by Robert Bathurst, who is a very interesting fellow who helped Kennedy start the original hotline. And he now works, he's a professor of national security studies at the Monterey Naval Postgraduate School. And he's brought Russian immigrants together with Americans and has uncovered amazing differences between the cultures, which in the spirit of what Rama was saying, one observes and takes into consideration and works within the limitations of, rather than criticizing and separating oneself off from them. And one of the things that has made Esalen's work in particular, which I know the most about, the most as successful as it is that we have a whole series of friends in the Soviet Union who coach us. If we want to get X done, we go to them and say, well, listen, how do you get this done within the limitations of your own system? So that's being discriminating without being judgmental. And then you just start to work through the cracks and between the walls, and you know, amazing things can happen. And we have a sort of a little research, you know, live research with Bathurst, bringing Russians and Americans together here at Esalen, and we're going to start doing it around the country and in Europe, so that we can start to get more and more information, so that when we go over to the Soviet Union, you know, we have more data to work with.
Here. Now that exchanges are sanctioned and vogue, what can and should the two governments do to facilitate these? And I have in mind the numbers increasing very dramatically in the near future, medium future. What can they do? What should they do?
Well, let me back up by saying that I think that the Reagan and Gorbachev are in a catch-22 situation. It's simply not going to happen, as Reagan suggested, that 50,000 American kids are going to go to the Soviet Union and 50,000 Russians are going to come back. The Soviets, as you well know, don't believe in free travel. The only people that leave the Soviet Union are selected people. And so that's one end of it. The other thing, which I think is more fundamental, is that the Soviets know that Reagan's call for more citizen diplomacy was in fact a diversionary tactic. The real agenda between the government is arms control. And Reagan went to Geneva, talked with Gorbachev for 3 days, and basically wouldn't even discuss it. And what the Soviets are saying, that until there's a breakthrough in the deadlocks on the real agenda, which is Star Wars, and the offensive and defensive weapons, all of which have to be negotiated together, they're not really interested in doing this other stuff. Now, I'm not judging it one way or another, but I think that that's the real catch between the two countries. And I think that there will be obviously a lot more happening, but I don't see the floodgates opening like they were, say, with Nixon and Kissinger.
Well, when it does-